Sophomore Tom Zipperley provided one of the greatest highlights of the 1972 season. North Carolina State kicked off to the Florida native. Zipperley took the ball at his two. He headed to the left side, picked up a wall of blockers, used his super acceleration and raced 98 yards for a touchdown. I asked Tom Zipperley if he realized how deep he was in his own end zone when he took that kickoff.
No, sir, I thought it was about 20-yard line. I really didn't know how long it was until, like, a little bit after the game, somebody told us 98. I didn't know it was near that long.
The ball comes in the air. You take it on the 2-yard line. You head to the left sideline. You picked up a pretty good wall of blockers there.
Yeah, I really did. I know Ricky Brown came in, and he's not even supposed to be on that team, and he threw me a real good block. Dana Carpenter and Tony Pepper, I think Tony got hurt in that. I know they knocked down some men for me, and well, that's what got me started. After that, I guess it was just on my own and what everybody else did.
When you looked over your right shoulder, did you see that big end pursuing down on you?
No, sir. I knew somebody was there. I could almost feel him there, and I knew I just had to get going or I wasn't going to make it.
Is that about the fastest you've ever ran?
I think so. I wanted to get in there pretty bad.
When you got in that end zone, what was the feeling?
I was just happy. I knew we needed to catch up, and I knew we needed all we could get, and I felt real good.
The defensive backfield provided a lot of thrills during the 1972 season. C.A. Wilson, the smallest man in major college football at 148 pounds, took this punt against Virginia Tech at his own 18. The young speedster from Sumter traveled 61 yards all the way to the Tech 21, the longest Gamecock punt return of the year. Wilson, a sophomore, was outstanding in his first year as a defensive back as he made 30 individual tackles, had 14 assists, and recovered a fumble. He also returned 4 kickoffs this year for a total of 75 yards. C.A. Wilson, one of the smallest, but one of the most exciting. Columbia's Mel Baxley, number 21, a junior college transfer, was another stalwart in the young defensive backfield. 6'1", 180 pounds, he tackled with a vengeance, 24 tackles and 16 assists. Alex Dobson, number 31, is another outstanding young sophomore defensive back. In this play against North Carolina State, Dobson made this spectacular interception at his own 31. He retreats to his 25, then heads to the far sidelines all the way to the State 41. Alex Dobson, 5'11", 178-pounder from Greer, showed great promise in the defensive backfield, but was hobbled this season by a leg injury. Defensive backfield coach Jerry Scoville labels Dobson a great defensive back. He returns to South Carolina for 2 more seasons. Senior Neville Files anchored the young defensive backfield. 5'9", 180 pounds from Greenwood, he led all defensive backs in individual tackles. He had 36. Small but aggressive, Files tackles in the open field with a vengeance. The highlight of the Gamecock football season was the upset victory over Florida State. That game was also the highlight in the career of Neville Files. Here, Rick Browns hit the ball carrier, jarred the pigskin loose. Alertly in the backfield, Neville Files comes up with the loose ball. This season, Neville Files recovered 2 fumbles, and he caused another. For his efforts in South Carolina's 24-21 victory over Florida State, Neville was honored by Sports Illustrated as National Defensive Back of the Week. Against Gary Huff, one of the leading passers in the country on that night, November 18th, before 36,000 screaming fans, young Neville Files intercepted 3 passes. Files can play any of 4 positions in the defensive secondary. He plays them all well. Throughout the season, it was senior Neville Files that kept the young secondary together. He had the experience. He provided the leadership. At the season's end, his spirit, hustle, and aggressiveness were rewarded. Neville Files, a small man with a courageous heart, was named Most Valuable Player of the Year. When the award was announced, Files received a standing ovation from his teammates. Neville Files has closed out a brilliant career at South Carolina. But on that night, against Florida State, he'll be remembered by Gamecock fans for many years to come. Speaking of that Florida State game, the score tied 21-21. Freshman Bob Marino, his first varsity play, he splits the uprights with a 37-yard field goal. The 3 points that proved to be the margin of victory. The Gamecocks went wild. They pounced upon the young freshman. He was motivated by the principle of self-preservation vacated the jumping, excited throng. Bobby Marino was not available for the opening kickoff. Excitement reigned. Marino told his coach, "I can't kick, coach. I can't see the ball through the tears in my eyes." Marino next year will replace number two.
A game that was to keep a regional television audience and a capacity Carter Stadium crowd in their seats till the end. The Carolina defense continued to play well in the first half, stopping the high-powered Wolfpack offense every time they threatened. An early North Carolina State drive was stopped when the Wolfpack receiver fumbled the football and middle guard Bubba Sugar, a Walhalla South Carolina junior, fell on the ball. With State knocking on the door in the second quarter and 1 yard to go for a first down, the defense again arose to the occasion. Defensive end Scott Blackman and free safety Bill Currier come up to make the stop on State's leading rusher Ted Brown for no gain, and again getting the offense the ball. The Carolina offense was again in high gear, and the running backs had a field day. Kevin Long, who gained 160 yards and 27 carries, breaks up the middle here for 26 yards and a first down, keeping a Carolina touchdown drive alive. It was on the next play that Carolina upped its lead to 10-0. Quarterback Jeff Grantz, again the center of attention as he runs the option left, turns upfield, getting some good blocking and doing some fine footwork for a 30-yard touchdown run. Grantz's ninth TD of the year. The Wolfpack took their first lead in the fourth quarter, but the Gamecocks came right back to tie the score in a field goal. Most of the yardage in that drive credited to tailback Clarence Williams. Hitting up the middle here, Williams races 55 yards to the State 18. Williams turning in 150 yards and 18 trips against State. State again charged in front, and with 3 minutes in the game, the pressure was again on the offense. But with a minute and a half to go in the game, Clarence Williams scored the touchdown that brought the Gamecocks within a point. Getting a good block from Scott Thomas, Williams scores from the five. Down by a point, the two-point conversion was needed to take the lead. Biting at the pressure of the situation, Jeff Grantz looks to the left corner of the end zone and finds Brian Nemeth for the 2 points that puts Carolina in the lead 22-21. However, this afternoon was reserved for the Wolfpack as they came right back to score the winning touchdown with just 9 seconds to go in the game. Another fine effort for Coach Jim Carlin's team, but in the end, a disappointing loss. A couple of the top players from the exciting North Carolina State contest, fullback Kevin Long and defensive back Bill Currier. Long, a junior from Clinton, South Carolina, spent some time on the Carolina campus with Frankie Clary of Kingstree, South Carolina, while Currier, a junior from Glen Burnie, Maryland, chats with Rita Chastain of Greenville, South Carolina. The Gamecocks were finally returning to the friendly confines of Williams-Brice Stadium for the ninth game of the season. Nursing numerous injuries from the three-game road trip, the Gamecocks were to suffer probably their most disappointing loss of the year. Carolina looked like they were going to have things pretty much their own way early in the game. After recovering a Mountaineer fumble, it took only 3 plays to score when Jeff Grantz found tailback Clarence Williams all alone in the left corner of the end zone for a touchdown. However, after that, Appalachian State put their offense in high gear, and Carolina never was able to catch up, dropping a tough 39-34 decision. The game did produce more new standards for the Carolina record book. Quarterback Jeff Grantz, among the nation's leading scorers all year, set the school touchdown record on this play as he skips around right in for his 26th career touchdown. Grantz, also holder of the school record for touchdown responsibility, later teamed up with his favorite target, split end Philip Logan, for an 81-yard touchdown pass. This play represented the longest touchdown pass for a Carolina team since 1938. For Logan, averaging over 20 yards per catch, it was his fourth touchdown of the season. Still, for all the offensive fireworks, the 39-34 loss, a bitter pill to swallow. Top performances in the Appalachian State game were turned in by defensive tackle David Prezioso and split end Philip Logan. Prezioso, a sophomore from Columbia, is seen here visiting with lovely Joan Harper of Conway, South Carolina. Logan, a sophomore from Richmond, Virginia, spends some of his spare time with Gail Gray of Columbia. A much improved Wake Forest team furnished the opposition the next week at the cockpit, and the Gamecocks were primed to shake the effects of a 3-game losing streak. The defense, unhappy with the Appalachian State loss, redeemed itself early. With the Deacons driving early in the game, the Carolina secondary played alert ball in this pass play. Free safety Bill Currier, a junior from Glen Burnie, Maryland, gathered in this deflected pass and got the offense good field position for a scoring drive. The defense continued to make life miserable for the Deacons in the second quarter. Cornerback Henry Laws, a senior from Conway, South Carolina, gets good position on a Wake Forest receiver and picks off one of his two passes of the afternoon. The offense was also doing its part, getting almost 500 yards total offense. Jeff Grantz through the air was on target, and the receivers were doing their usual fine job. Tight end Brian Nemeth making a sensational grab of this Grantz aerial that put the Gamecocks in scoring position. Kevin Long, needing only 58 yards entering the game to become the first 1,000-yard rusher in Carolina history, got five of those yards and a touchdown on this burst up the middle. Once again, Carolina's outstanding offensive line giving Long plenty of support. Later in the second quarter, it was Kevin Long's turn to put his name in the Carolina record book. Turning left end on the option, the hard-running junior picks up 13 yards to make him the first Carolina back to rush for more than 1,000 yards in a season, breaking the old record of 998 yards established by Steve Wadiak back in 1950. There were more big plays and records to fall against the Demon Deacons. Senior flanker Randy Chastain shows his outstanding speed in this wing-back reverse, turning left end behind some outstanding blocking, won especially by offensive guard Steve Corson. Chastain turns on the Jets for an electrifying 53-yard touchdown gallop. The Chastain touchdown pushed the Carolina lead to 28-0. Later in the third quarter, place kicker Bobby Marino, a senior from Atlanta, Georgia, placed his name in the Carolina record book with a 26-yard field goal. Marino's 24th career three-pointer, a school record. There was more excitement reserved for the final period of action, and again, it was the passing tandem of Jeff Grantz and Philip Logan that supplied it. Grantz finding the sophomore split end open over the middle. The result, a 70-yard pass and run play. When the clock finally ran out, another exciting afternoon of football at Williams-Brice Stadium, Carolina had posted win number 6, a 37-26 decision over the Demon Deacons of Wake Forest. Two of the top players in the victory over Wake Forest were cornerback Henry Laws and offensive guard Brad Klein. Laws, a senior from Conway, South Carolina, strolls the Carolina campus with May Reagan of Somerton, South Carolina. Klein, a senior from Washington, D.C., spends most of his extra time with his pretty wife, Jan. Now, the preliminaries were over, and it was time for the game the entire Palmetto State waits for. The regular season finale between Carolina and Clemson, an ancient rivalry that dates back to 1896. In South Carolina, it's the game. For the second time this season, over 57,000 fans crowded their way into the Williams-Brice Stadium. This November afternoon was bathed in Gamecock garnet and black and tiger orange. Little did these fans know, they were about to witness a record-shattering day never before seen in the history of Carolina football. Junior tailback Clarence Williams entered the game needing 144 yards to become the Gamecock's second 1,000-yard rusher in history and second of this season. He got off to a good start toward a milestone he would reach later in the afternoon with this 37-yard run for a touchdown early in the first quarter. Carolina becoming only the sixth major college team in history to produce two 1,000-yard rushers in a season. Quarterback Jeff Grantz, playing before the home folks for the last time, gave them a performance they'd never forget. The Bel Air Maryland senior ripped the Tigers for five touchdown passes, a school record. This one going for 34 yards to fellow senior Randy Chastain. Grantz was pulling more rabbits out of his hat just before halftime. With only 7 seconds to go in the half, Grantz getting good protection from his outstanding offensive line of seniors Mike McCabe, Brad Klein, and E.C. Smith, junior Steve Corson and Jerome Province gave the Clemson defense the double pump, then unloaded a 41-yard strike to split-end Philip Logan, breaking away from a Clemson defender at the 5-yard line and dancing into the end zone. The Carolina fans were enjoying every minute of it. their favorites raced to the locker room with a 35-6 advantage. There was more to come in the second 30 minutes, and as you would expect, quarterback Jeff Grantz was in the middle of it. It was on this play early in the third quarter that Grantz became the Carolina total offensive record holder for one season with 2,071 yards. This 34-yard run, just one of 12 carries that produced 122 yards on the ground for Grantz. It was an effort like this that earned Grantz All-American honors. Five of Grantz's nine completions for 158 yards went for touchdowns, like this one to Kevin Long out of the backfield for 9 yards. One of a school record 16 touchdowns on the year for Grantz, who is to be named the National Back of the Week for his performance against the Tigers. The defense was also getting its share of credit in this victory, again making the big plays when they had to be made. Columbia sophomore defensive tackle David Prezioso helped stop a Tiger drive with a sack of Clemson quarterback Mike O'Kane, a play that was typical of the Gamecocks' defensive effort most of the year. This was the kind of football Carolina fans grew to enjoy under head coach Jim Carlin, and this Saturday afternoon was one they would long remember, a 56-20 shellacking of cross-state rival Clemson. This impressive victory gave Carolina a 7-4 record and a trip to the Tangerine Bowl.
Banks, a lot of years ago, you first set foot on the Clemson campus. Can you recall those days?
Yes, Jim. Very vividly, because I think your first trip to any university has become very vivid to you. Of course, Clemson was a very small school at that time, and we had about 1,200 students. At that time, it was a military school also, so when your parents brought you here, they brought you and left you and didn't intend to pick you up until Christmas. Being a military school, of course, it had a lot of regimentation that took part in it. Wasn't that difficult, I don't think, but Clemson was an entirely different university, or school then. I think it just became a university in the past 16 years. Coming early, as we were allowed to do back then before school opened up, as they do now, and football, of course, the freshmen could not play with the varsity. We had about 40 freshmen to show up, of which about, I think, 18 of us were on scholarship. Because in those days, Jim, there was very little financial aid. I think if we check back, it's somewhere in 1934 that they first started trying to get money to support the athletic department from a scholarship standpoint. But being a military, there were a lot of boys that had participated in high school and did make it at Clemson University. As your program goes on and you talk to other coaches, I think you'll find that we had a high percentage of boys that high school football but were not under any financial aid here at Clemson to begin with, and turned out to be real fine athletes and developed. They were put on scholarships as went by, but in our days there were very little financial aid for the football or any other athlete as far as that's concerned. But we came in, Coach Jones was our freshman, took us all out and introduced us to each other as we were putting on our shoulder pads and helmets and etc. like that standpoint. And about that part, but I think most of us will agree that by being a military school, those who could play two or three different sports were more inclined to do this. Because you didn't have to drill. If you were out for use you for afternoon drill when you were practicing your different sports. So therefore, that was one of the main reasons you found that these athletes that played football, basketball, track, or baseball, they did this because it was something they enjoyed, but it also let them get out of something.
Your impressions, and if you can put these all together in a little bit of a dissertation here, it'd be nice. First as a player, then as a coach, and then as a spectator at Clemson, the emotions that you feel in all three of those areas.
Well, I guess each area has its own place, and I think everyone enjoyed participating, regardless of how young I was. Playing at Clemson was a great thrill to me because I came from a real small town. I wasn't really sure I could do anything when I got here. I was told that, but you have to prove to yourself the things that you could do. I was very fortunate to come when we had some real outstanding athletes to come to Clemson. Before that, before 1936, I think they'd struggled tremendously trying to produce football teams, basketball teams, and other sports. But coming as an athlete with some fine players such as Joe Payne, who was our captain my senior year, Seegers, and a lot of the others that really turned out to be fine, boy by the name of Shad Bryant, who's not with us anymore, but he was a great runner. Joe Blaylock, who made All-American, I think, twice. He was here as a sophomore when I was a senior, but those people were able to come in and help us develop into a respectable football team. And I enjoyed playing very much with it. It was a lot of competition. I wasn't one of those who was blessed with that spoon that people might be thinking of, because I had to fight for a starting position, and I was not able to win the starting position until the middle of my junior year. I was a second stringer, and it looked like I was going to be a bohunk, which are those who don't even make the trip. But a little encouragement from other people, and it's a lot of good coaching that brought me along, and I really enjoyed participating for Clemson, and when we were able to have a real good year in 1938, which was my junior year. I think it was 8-1-1. We lost to Tennessee and was tied by, I believe, VPI at that time. Then we thought we were well on the way and had hoped even at that time to maybe get a bowl bid, but of course no one knew where Clemson was. Like now, you travel on the airplane. We got on the train, rode, and turned around and came right back home. But our senior year, everyone was pretty much ready to go. We lost some real fine players like Charlie Wood, who was a signer, but Red Sharp came in and replaced him. And then, as I said, Joe Blaylock came into his own. George Fritz, who were real outstanding boys from a player standpoint, tackling in. So there again, we began to gel, and everyone knew that we could win if we played together, which we tried to do. And then we came into the year that we only lost to Tulane, and that was a matter of not getting the extra point. It was a 7-6 ball game. So we went ahead from there and was fortunate enough to be selected to go to the Cotton Bowl. It's difficult for me to, I could reminisce for years and years about the playing days of the fine people that I played with and all the hard work they put into it for me to receive the recognition that I did. And I think everyone realizes that no athlete, regardless how good or poor he might be, in order for him to receive the recognition, he certainly has to have the fine athletes along with him. And I certainly had the best.
As a coach, can you recall those days? I'm sure you can.
Well, let me say, first, I don't think it's any greater profession in the world than being a coach. You have the opportunity to work with young people. You have your ups and downs because you have your athlete that comes along with the tremendous ability that can do everything, and yet you can't get to the heart of him and get it from him. Then you have the other one that is a fighter, a scrapper, that everyone looks for. If you could see this in the high school athlete, you would know exactly the one to choose. But that's impossible. But you do have the opportunity to work with these people, to talk to them, to try to get them over the humps and to try to get the best from each one. So again, I'd have to say that the thing that I remember about my coaching days was the opportunity to work with these young people that have meant so much to Clemson University and to me in my particular life. We had ups and downs. Under Coach Howard, I think Clemson enjoyed by far the greatest winning tradition that Clemson has ever known, and probably most of any of them in the state of South Carolina and in the Atlantic Coast Conference that is now known. We had some in-between times which were not too good, but one thing about it, we had a good, close-knitted coaching staff. Everybody worked for the purpose of trying to win. We weren't looking to go off some other place and try to get a head coaching job. We're trying to win some other place and try to get a head coaching job. We're trying to make everything that Clemson be the best. Of course, you have to say bowls. Cotton Bowl that I played in, then the Gator Bowls, the Orange Bowls, LSU that we played in, Sugar Bowl, and finally the Blue Bonnet. They were highlights for them as players, the highlights for the coaches. As far as a life career is concerned, there were certain highlights. I don't know that I could single out any game that meant more than anything else to us.
More than anything else.
If I had to judge, just making a guess as to what group of boys probably were the most talented. Now, I don't know that they performed any better or they won any more games, but the group of people to me that was the most talented from the number standpoint was the group that we took to play LSU and the group the following year that we took out to play in the Blue Bonnet Bowl. They were tremendous athletes, and I don't mean 10. I'm talking about we had probably about 35 or 40 boys that could have played first string, offensive or defensive, on almost any team, far as I was concerned. They were just great athletes. We've had others maybe that were better individually, but far as a group, that was the most talented group that we've ever had. Again, I would have to say coaching is the greatest thing in the world. And I think everyone is blessed that has the opportunity to work with these young people.
What happens? What are the emotions when the turn of a decade comes and the 70s begin and Banks McFadden is no longer associated as a coach or a player at Clemson University? He now is a spectator.
Well, that's difficult to say. Of course, at the beginning, you have a very sinking, a very low feeling. Having played or participated worked with young people all your life. You had a feeling that, well, what is it? What do you know? What else can you do? Have you accomplished anything during the time when you were working with these people, either as a player or as a coach? And you go out and see things begin to happen. You realize that the clock will not stop, and that's always been true. But it was a sinking feeling. I definitely felt it from a football standpoint, coaching, or basketball standpoint. But still, on the other hand, I was born and raised, as far as Clemson was concerned, yeah. That was what my heart was set on for everything. So I was looking for them to improve, to succeed in everything that they did. For those who took over, I guess I was jealous. I can't say that I wasn't, because I think after you work with something so long, you like to be a part of it, and you're envious of those that do have the opportunity to continue to work as we had for so many years. I